All right, so welcome to another deep dive.
Yeah.
Today, we're going to be looking at gambling addiction.
Okay.
And, you know, it's something that a lot of people probably think they understand, but when you actually look into, like, the neuroscience and psychology behind it, it gets really fascinating.
Uh-huh.
And we have what looks like a transcript from maybe, like, a YouTube video or something like that
yeah.
that really gets into, like, all the nitty-gritty details.
Interesting, yeah.
So I'm excited to kind of dive into this with you.
Yeah, me too.
So one of the things that this source really emphasizes right off the bat is how gambling addiction is often compared to, like, substance abuse,
right?
But how it's actually quite different.
Mm-hmm.
And that there's no, like, physical substance involved.
Right.
But the grip that it can have on people is just as powerful, if not more so.
Definitely, yeah.
Which I thought was really interesting.
Yeah.
And, you know, you hear all these stories of people losing everything, you know, their homes, their families, their life savings, all because of this gambling addiction.
It's wild.
So what makes it so hard to break free?
Right.
And this transcript really goes into that. And kind of the first thing it looks at is dopamine.
Okay.
Which, you know, everyone kind of knows about dopamine. It's like the pleasure chemical.
Oh, it makes it feel good.
Right. That's released when we do something pleasurable.
Exactly.
But the interesting thing that this transcript brings up is that dopamine actually surges the most.
Oh.
Not when you get the reward, but when you're anticipating it.
Interesting.
So it's not about winning.
Hey.
It's about, like, the thrill of the chase.
Yeah.
The possibility of winning.
The anticipation.
And that really, I think, starts to explain how this can spiral out of control.
Absolutely.
Especially with games that are designed to play on that.
Yeah, yeah, like slot machines or something like that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So
are you trying to tell me that, like, all these games are designed to manipulate my brain?
Well, I don't know if it's that sinister.
Okay.
But this transcript does highlight how how slot machines and roulette wheels and all that are carefully designed to really tap into our psychological vulnerabilities and especially, like, our dopamine reward system.
Right.
You know? Think about all the flashing lights, the spinning wheels.
The sounds,
the sounds.
Mm-hmm.
It's all designed to heighten that anticipation and that excitement.
It's true. It's true.
Even if you're losing, you know, you still kind of get that rush.
Right.
So I thought that was super interesting.
Yeah.
But then it goes beyond that and it explains how these games also create this illusion of control.
Oh, interesting.
Which leads to what they call the gambler's fallacy.
Okay, the gambler's fallacy.
And they use this example of, like, a roulette wheel. Oh. Imagine you see black come up 20 times in a row.
Wow. Okay, 20 times.
What are the odds of it being black on the 21st spin?
Well, it feels like red has got to be due,
right.
But logically, I know it's still 50-50.
Still 50-50.
Each spin is independent.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that's the gambler's fallacy.
So it's like our brains want to see a pattern.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Our brains are wired to look for patterns even when they don't exist.
Even where they don't exist.
And so we start to think that past results are going to somehow influence future outcomes.
Right.
And that leads to all this kind of irrational betting behavior.
It's like you think you can predict the future.
Yeah, exactly.
Based on what's happened in the past.
And the source even shares this anecdote about witnessing 21 consecutive black spins in Las Vegas.
Oh, wow.
Like, imagine the tension in that room.
Yeah, I can't even imagine.
So we've got the dopamine rush.
Yeah.
We've got the anticipation trap. And we've got this gambler's fallacy.
Right.
All working together.
It's a recipe for disaster.
Yeah, to really create this perfect storm for addiction.
Definitely.
But is it really just about what's happening in our brains?
That's a good question.
And that's where the transcript starts to look at the broader context of gambling addiction.
Right.
And it argues that while the, like, neurochemical processes are crucial, there's more to the story.
Okay.
Social and economic factors also play a really big role.
Oh, interesting.
Especially for people who are dealing with poverty, unemployment, social isolation.
Right. So maybe it's like a way to escape from those circumstances.
That's exactly what the source suggests.
Okay.
That it can be seen as a way to seek control in a world that feels really chaotic and unpredictable.
Right. It makes it.
So I thought that was super interesting.
Yeah, definitely.
And then there's also this whole issue of, like, the normalization of gambling.
Oh.
You know, casinos popping up everywhere online. Gambling's so accessible.
It's everywhere.
It's almost impossible to avoid.
Yeah.
So that's another layer to this whole thing.
Yeah, it really is.
So this transcript's really challenging my preconceived notions about gambling addiction.
Interesting.
It's not just some personal failing. It's this really complex issue with roots in our biology and our psychology and even our society as a whole.
It's true.
So
yeah, this is fascinating.
I'm really curious to see where this goes from here.
Absolutely. And it really does get into like the ethical implications of how we as a society approach this whole gambling thing.
Yeah.
It goes into this whole debate about prohibition versus regulation.
Oh, interesting.
And it really kind of highlights the complexities of that whole thing.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's a debate that's been going on forever.
Right.
Right? Like, is gambling inherently harmful?
Yeah. And should it just be banned outright?
Uh-huh.
But then you have the argument that, you know, prohibition often just drives these activities underground.
Exactly.
Makes them more dangerous.
Right. It's like the whole prohibition.
Yeah, the prohibition era.
Yeah. The U.S.
Exactly.
Like banning alcohol didn't stop people from drinking.
Yeah, it just made it more dangerous.
It just created this whole black market.
Right.
So is there like a better way?
That's the question.
To address the harms of gambling without just like banning it completely?
Yeah, I mean, the source seems to kind of lean towards regulation as being a more
effective
approach.
But how do you even regulate that?
Right.
Like without taking away people's freedom.
The $1 million question.
To like spend their money how they want.
Exactly. And the source kind of acknowledges that finding the right balance
is
super tricky.
Yeah.
But it does suggest things like,
you know, age restrictions, spending limits, maybe even like public awareness campaigns to kind of help with this whole problem.
So it's more about minimizing harm and providing support to people who are struggling.
Exactly.
Rather than just trying to like eliminate gambling.
Yeah, that seems to be the direction they're going.
Okay, that makes sense.
And it really emphasizes education and early intervention.
Oh, that's interesting.
Like if we can just teach people
about
the risks.
Right.
And how to recognize the signs, maybe we can prevent a lot of this addiction from happening in the first place.
That makes sense.
But what about people who are already kind of stuck in that cycle?
Yeah, like what hope
is there for them?
What does the source say about recovery?
Yeah.
Well, it definitely acknowledges that it's not easy.
Right.
But it does offer a message of hope.
Okay.
It really stresses that recovery is possible with the right support and the right treatment.
So, like, what kind of treatment are we talking about here?
Well, the transcript goes into a few things.
Okay.
One of them is cognitive behavioral therapy.
Okay, CBT.
Or CBT.
And how does that help?
So, it explains how CBT can help people identify and then challenge those distorted thought patterns that are contributing to their behavior.
So, like, what would be an example of a distorted thought pattern?
Well, think about that gambler's fallacy we were talking about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Someone with a gambling addiction might truly believe that if they've been losing, they're due for a win.
Right. Like they're due
they're due
win big.
Yeah, exactly.
So CBT would help them to kind of look at that belief and be like, okay, wait a minute.
And recognize that it's based on faulty logic.
Right.
It's not actually how probability works.
Right. It's not how the math works. So it's like retraining your brain to think more rationally.
More rationally about gambling. Yeah.
And it also focuses on like coping mechanisms.
Yeah.
Right. To manage those urges and cravings.
Exactly. And it really highlights building a support network.
Oh,
whether that's family, friends, support groups.
Okay.
Having people to lean on.
Yeah.
It's a huge difference.
So it sounds like it's really a holistic process.
It is. It is.
It's not just about the behavior.
It's about the thoughts and the emotions.
Yeah.
The social circumstances.
It's like treating the whole person.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And the source does say that it's a long and challenging journey.
Yeah, for sure.
There are going to be setbacks.
Mm-hmm.
But with commitment and support and the right tools, people can break free.
That's good to hear.
And reclaim their lives.
It is. It's good to hear that there's hope.
There is. There is.
What about like preventing addiction? Is there anything in here about that?
It does touch on early intervention.
Okay.
And education.
Mm-hmm.
Like teaching young people about the risks and equipping them with the skills to make good choices.
Okay.
You know, maybe we can reduce the number of people.
Right. Reduce the number of people
who develop these problems later on.
Right. Because we often focus so much on like treatment.
Yeah.
After the fact.
Right. After it's already a problem.
But maybe we should be putting more effort into
prevention. And the source emphasizes the role of parents, educators, policymakers.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we need to create a culture that promotes responsible gambling habits.
Yeah, so it's like shifting the conversation from just accepting it as a harmless form of entertainment to really acknowledging,
acknowledging
that there are risks involved and that we need to take steps to mitigate those things.
The transcript is really making me think about this whole thing.
Yeah, it's fascinating in a new way.
Isn't it?
It's not just a personal choice.
Right.
There's all these factors.
Yeah, there's so much going on.
You know, brain chemistry, social influences.
Economic pressures.
It's a lot more complex than I think I ever realized.
Yeah.
So
it's a good reminder that addiction is rarely just about willpower.
Right.
Or like personal failing.
Right. It's more than that.
It's this complex interplay of all these factors.
And by understanding those complexities, maybe we can come up with better strategies for prevention and treatment and support.
I think that's a really good point.
Yeah. And one of the things that really stood out to me was how the transcript connects like the individual experience of gambling addiction to these like larger societal issues.
Right.
You know, it's not just about like what's going on in your brain. Yeah. It's about the environment you're in.
Yeah. All those facts.
The messages you're receiving, all of that.
Yeah. And one of the things that it points out is how much more accessible gambling has become.
Oh, for sure.
In recent years.
I mean,
you think about online casinos.
Right.
Sports betting apps.
It's everywhere.
Lottery tickets at the grocery store.
Yeah. It's hard to avoid.
It's everywhere.
Does the transcript talk about how that might be?
It does. Yeah.
It's contributing.
It touches on that.
Okay.
It points out that this constant exposure.
Right.
Can really normalize it.
Yeah.
To the point where it's just seen as like harmless entertainment.
Yeah. Like it's no big deal.
Right.
And for some people, it probably isn't.
Right. Exactly. But for others.
Yeah.
It can be like a gateway.
Yeah. Like a slippery slope.
Yeah.
Especially when you consider like those dopamine reward systems we were talking about.
Exactly.
If those are getting triggered constantly.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's easy to see how that could get out of control.
Lead to problems. Yeah.
And the transcript talks about how certain people might be more vulnerable to gambling problems.
Yeah, it's just like a combination of genetics and life experiences.
So it's not like a one-size-fits-all.
Not at all, yeah.
Okay.
It really emphasizes that addiction is this complex interplay of nature and nurture.
So some people might just be more predisposed.
Right. They might have like a genetic predisposition, while others might develop problems as a result of like trauma or stress, mental health issues, things like that.
So it's not as simple as just telling people to stop gambling.
No, definitely not.
It's about looking at all these underlying factors.
Exactly. And I think that's one of the key takeaways here.
Okay.
It encourages us to have like a more nuanced and compassionate understanding of gambling addiction.
Yeah, because it's easy to just blame people.
Right. And this is saying it's not about blame. It's about understanding the complexity.
And ultimately, it's about empowering people to make informed choices and seek help when they need it.
And it does a good job of outlining those treatment options.
Therapy, support groups.
Yes. Medication, all kinds of things.
And it also highlights the importance of addressing any like co-occurring mental health issues.
Yeah. It says a lot of people with gambling addiction also struggle with anxiety and depression, substance abuse, things like that.
So it's really about treating the whole person.
Exactly.
Yeah. Not just the addiction itself.
The whole person.
This has been a really insightful deep dive.
Yeah. I've learned a lot.
We've covered so much.
So much.
From the neuroscience of dopamine to the societal factors that contribute to this whole thing.
It's complex.
What stands out to you as the most important takeaway?
I think for me, it's understanding those underlying mechanisms.
Okay.
You know, whether it's gambling or substance abuse
or
any other kind of compulsive behavior.
Yeah.
It's crucial to recognize that there are these real biological and psychological processes.
Yeah. It's not just a choice.
It's not just about willpower.
And it's also important to remember that recovery is possible.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, it might not be easy.
Right.
But with the right support.
Yeah.
People can overcome addiction.
Uh-huh.
So as we wrap up this deep dive, if you or someone you know is struggling, please know that you're not alone. Mm-hmm. There are resources available, there's support, and there's hope for recovery.
Absolutely.